What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. UML, or Unified Modeling Language, is our topic for today. And contrary to many beliefs, it isn't a programming language, but it is a graphical notation used to draw diagrams of an object-oriented system. This modeling language describes and defines several diagrams, but in this video, we will be covering two of them, object diagrams and class diagrams, as we will be using these two a lot in our upcoming videos. Later on, I will try to add more videos to this series. Today, we will especially focus on class diagrams, as they represent the main building block of any object-oriented solution. While trying to cover the basics of class diagrams, we will also be discussing the difference between association, aggregation, and composition, as I figured they somehow really fit within this video, so bear with me. Okay, a class diagram is a very simple graphical representation of the classes in our system and the relationships they share. Each class representation has three sections: the name of the class at the top, the attributes in the middle, and the behaviors or methods at the bottom. The different relationships between classes are shown by different types of arrows, which we will discuss in a bit. Next to the attributes and methods, you can add the plus sign to indicate that this field is public. The minus sign indicates that it's private, and the number sign or hash sign indicates that it is protected. The type of our attributes and the arguments passed to and returned by a method can be specified, as you can see in this example. Inside a set of parentheses, next to the method name, we can specify the type of the arguments of our method, and after a colon, we can specify the type of the returned variables by this method, along with some default values. Now let's take our famous bank account class as an example. Fill in its attributes and its methods, and suppose that we have two other classes, like types of bank accounts, the Savings Account class and the Miles Account class. Both of them are bank accounts, therefore they share an IsA relationship with the bank account class. But on top of the attributes present in the bank account class, the account ID, the balance, and the account owner's name, the Savings Account has an interest rate attribute, and the Miles Account class has a rewards attribute and a bunch of methods. The relationship between these classes is obviously inheritance, and it is specified in a class diagram using this arrow. Now let's add to our application a person or customer class with a name and an ID or whatever you like. Every customer is supposedly eligible to have multiple bank accounts, because why not? So it is like we added in our customer class attributes a list of the bank account class. And because we are a bank and we want to rip our customers off their money, let's add an additional feature they didn't ask for and let them pay for it. Let's allow our customers, using an existing bank account, to create several sub-accounts within the same account. You see, these sub-accounts are not bank accounts on their own, like the savings or the miles one. We don't need to provide the owner's name all over again. They exist within the bank account class, and the customer can have one or several sub-accounts. Without a bank account, there is no way to create a sub-account. The customer has to have an account in the bank before being able to create a sub-account. Let's lay out the relationships between our classes now. A customer can have multiple bank accounts, but a specific bank account can only belong to one customer. Same applies to the sub-account class. A specific sub-account can only belong to one bank account, but any given bank account can have multiple sub-accounts. This is referred to as one-to-many relationship. You may also be aware of the many-to-many or the one-to-one relationships. These define an association between our objects. And in a UML diagram, an association is represented with the arrow you can see in front of you. However, in our case, the customer class is kind of a container for the bank account class, which is called the contained in this case. And the bank account class is also a container, but for the sub-account class, which in this case is the contained. This is referred to as a has-a relationship or a directional association, also known as an aggregation, which in our case is what we have in both cases. We can say that a customer has a or several bank accounts, or the bank account has a or several sub-accounts. So let's replace these association arrows with aggregation arrows in our class diagram, and take a look at something I hinted at a little bit ago in this video. If we delete our customer class, the bank account class can still be used by our system. It will, in some way, still be useful. In this video, we even created it before we created the customer class. But what about the sub-account class? Can we say the same about it? Can the sub-account class exist without the bank account class? If we delete all bank account classes from our application, the customer class may still be useful in some way to the application. But this sub-account class, what are we gonna do with it? Well, nothing. It is useless. And when the contained object cannot exist without its container, this is called a restricted aggregation, or a composition, and that is exactly what we have in this case. So, we can only update the arrow linking the bank account class to the sub-account class into a composition arrow. However, the one linking the customer and bank account classes has to be left as an aggregation. Now, you may be asking the question, when do we have an association then? We will always end up with either an aggregation or a composition, right? Well, let's create a bank event class with a title and a date. The title will be the event the bank is hosting. It could be a branch opening or anything else. And the date would be the date of the event. Let's also add a method in the customer class called subscribe, where a person can subscribe to a particular event. Now, this is obviously a many-to-many association, because many customers can subscribe to as many events as they want, or no events at all. And any single event can be watched by as many customers as we want, or no customers at all. However, this is clearly not an aggregation, because we do not have the concept of container and contained, as a person cannot contain an event, or vice versa. When a person subscribes to an event, it just takes, for example, the date of this event and adds it to his or her Google Calendar. That's it. You can also see that neither the customer class contains a bank event among its attributes, nor the bank event class contains a customer class among its attributes. So the has-a relationship is non-existent in this case. Hence, we only have an association here represented by this arrow in the UML class diagram. Now that our class diagram is complete, we will briefly go over the object diagram. It is very similar to the class diagram, but instead of representing classes, we represent objects, which means that we have actual real-world examples and values. They show what a system will look like and what its current state is at a given time. Take this instance, this object created using the bank account class, and fill the attributes of this object. That is how an object is represented in an object diagram. In the first section, we actually write the object's name as it appears in our program or application, and the attributes are represented by their actual values at a certain point in time while our application is running. Let's take this further and try to derive some more objects from our previous classes to complete our object diagram by filling in dummy information. And here it is, a complete representation of our previous class diagram model as an object diagram. As you can see, the relationship arrows previously used in the class diagram are kept exactly the same when deriving the corresponding object diagram. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.